Nisan Bulavinaka, and a warm welcome to Speak Your Mind on Gold FM, only the classic hits. I'm Louise, your host today on our episode that we have live on radio and a delayed coverage shown on FBC TV every Tuesday night as well as Wednesday morning. Now, thank you so much for your company. Our guest in the studio today, who has been kind enough to come and talk to us, is from the Ministry of Health, Vinesh Warren Rama, and he's the health inspector. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Luis, and thank you to all the listeners of ABC.
Well, it's really great to have you. I know I've spoken to you before, but Mr. Rama, maybe you'd like to tell us from what part of Fiji were you brought up?
Okay, I'm originally from Nakasi, born and brought up in Nakasi.
Okay.
And attended MGM High School and medical school in Fiji.
So you've been doing this job for a long time, haven't
you? I've been in the ministry for past 18 years and currently manning the vector-borne control unit in Fiji for Ministry of Health for past 5 years.
So you're actually a veteran. So you have children?
Yeah, I'm married. I've got my wife is from Visayas Vunda, and I have two kids, both boys.
Okay, then. So we might as well get into it. It's been seen that there is a surge in the number of dengue fever cases reported, Mr. Rama. Now, what is the ministry's response to this?
Currently, we have seen, we have been having dengue since last year. Previous year, we had a big outbreak. And then with all the initiative from the government, from the ministry and the community at large, we saw a decline in the dengue and in dengue cases. And later last year, we have seen this, the number of cases in the northern division and in the western division has started to reemerge, has started to rise again. For this year, a total of 85 confirmed cases has been recorded. There's been around 40 or more cases in the northern division and also in the western division. But for the northern division, we know it's basically in the Lambasa area. And for the western division, it's from Singatoka, Nandi, Lautokaba. We have small clusters or small number from each subdivision in the western division. And just two cases been recorded in the central division. There may be more cases, but which may not be coming to the doctors or those with the mild fever, things like that, they may not have turned up. But we know, okay, dengue is in Fiji, and the challenge is how to prevent it from getting into a big outbreak.
Okay, so last year was pretty bad, wasn't it? We did have a few deaths.
Yes, I think, yeah, previous year and early last year, we had a dengue outbreak, but then it was controlled. We had a couple of deaths, and probably later on, Dr. Kama can explain why the reasons of death was. But normally people might say why we have dengue outbreak and things like that. It's basically because of there's a couple of components in that. One is the government is doing whatever is needed to be done. But the most important thing is for any disease or for the community to prevent having any diseases, the community themselves has to play their part. The dengue is spread by mosquitoes, and these mosquitoes basically breed around or close to house or inside the house, like in flower vase, pot plants, drums, tires, any artificial containers, plastic containers, or things like that, which are close to the house. So basically what happens is these mosquitoes, they bite humans, they suck the blood to lay eggs, and they fly to a closer range of water-containing article, and then they lay eggs there, see? So then they come back again to feed on the blood again for the next generation of eggs. So that's why their habitat is, they stay mostly inside the house, under dark, shady areas, or around the house in the shady areas, in the dark areas, and so that they can come and feed as easily as possible and closer to the breeding grounds as well.
Okay, so what would you advise a person at home? What should they do to avoid getting bitten by mosquitoes? Sometimes it's really hard to get to avoid getting bitten by mosquitoes, but what would be your advice to everyone that is staying in the house and having a chance of getting bitten by the mosquitoes?
Okay, the main thing is like there's two things we need to do. One is to prevent the mosquitoes from breeding. So you have to clean up your compounds and destroy all the breeding containers, remove the breeding sites so that these mosquitoes can't breed. So if the mosquitoes are not breeding, there won't be many mosquitoes to bite. And then the next thing is, which is another very important thing, is people need to protect themselves from getting bitten by the mosquitoes. So either you use mosquito repellents, or you use you can have mosquito barriers like mosquito nets, screens in the windows and doors, or in some buildings you'll see they have sealed windows with air conditionings, which is an expensive tool, but that's one of the ways. Most of the buildings you'll see nowadays, they build air conditioned rooms with sealed windows. But in other areas where everyone is not able to afford those things, you just put the mosquito nets, or just simply use some kind of repellents. Or even by repellents, or by preventing yourself from being bitten by the mosquitoes, you can wear long pants and long shirts.
Right.
See? So.
And socks too.
Socks too. And avoid being bitten by the mosquitoes during the early morning hours and early evening hours. Eh?
Okay.
Because dengue mosquitoes normally bite in the morning and in the afternoon, not during the daytime or during the midnight time.
Now that's very important. Yes. So early in the morning and in the evenings, just probably when the sun goes down?
Yes.
Around that time?
Down and when the sun is about to come out.
Okay.
So that's why you'll see some most of the time when there's an outbreak, you'll see there's some insecticide spraying carried out early in the morning, or if not late in the afternoon.
Okay, well, we'll be back for more, Mr. Rama, on Gold FM, only the classic hits. This is Speak Your Mind, and we will be covering more on dengue fever. Welcome back to Speak Your Mind on Gold FM, only the classic hits. Thanks a lot for your company, and we now have joining us on the show, and very nice to have you, the National Advisor for Communicable Diseases, Dr. Mike Kama. Thank you indeed for your time, and welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you for having me here.
And we have been talking about the recent surge in the number of dengue fever cases reported, and we've had our friend here, Mr. Rama, who has explained about, you know, keeping your compound clean and all that. But Mr. Kama, just a question. Now, why is it that we have dengue fever nearly every year?
Okay, so the Minister of Health acknowledges that there's been a lot of discussions on this in the literature and in the worldwide libraries. So basically, there's a myriad of factors that bring on dengue outbreaks. One of them is basically the type or the serotype of dengue virus that tends to circulate every now and then. So in Fiji, we've had in the past dengue 1 serotype that has been circulating. So most of the Fiji population is already somehow immune to this, meaning that they've been exposed in the past. so that you know, the second time around, they don't get infected as badly as they were the first time around. Eh? So they develop immunity to that. So in Fiji, that's what the minister has postulated, that our endemic strains for dengue is dengue 1. So that when a dengue 1 the virus comes along, we don't see really serious cases and so forth. So we'll have a mild case, maybe just a little bit of a surge, and it comes down again. So it's not a real big issue. But then when other serotypes come along, serotype 2, 3 or 4, basically there's 4 serotypes of dengue, then this is when outbreaks do happen. So the other factors that are there are basically mosquito factors, so that if the density of mosquito is quite high, then it will allow for the circulation of these viruses once you insert one, or one, you know, invades the communities. The other factor is primarily the vulnerability of the population. So, like I mentioned before, if the people aren't immune to these such diseases, they are not experienced or exposed to it before, and they can also, you know, there can be an outbreak happening at that time. So, the last one would be, you know, public health infrastructure, how clean our cities are, how clean our compounds are. So this is important. The sanitary bit is important, primarily because otherwise they would have areas where mosquitoes can breed, so the density goes up. So these are the main factors. There may be 4 of them that I've mentioned already, and they work either in unison or together. So if you can't control one, there's only little that we can control. Then the others will allow for this. But there's also the final factor that I did mention was climatic in nature. It only happens at certain times. So, and we look at the second half of a year into the first half of the following year. So this is when the biggest risks are for such dengue outbreaks to happen.
Winaka, Dr. Kama, very interesting indeed. But we'll be back for more on Speak Your Mind on Gold FM, only the classic hits. Very important visitors with us, the National Advisor for Communicable Diseases, Dr. Mike Kama. Well, we had last week the National Advisor for Non-Communicable Diseases. So there's a difference here, Dr. Kama. You might like to explain what communicable diseases involve.
Yes, thank you, Louise. There's communicable disease deals with mostly microorganisms, pathogenic microorganisms that they would like to say in the medical field. And basically, these are ones that will cause infections. So basically, they will spread from one person to another after they invade the human body. So these are the kinds of conditions that we talk about, such as dengue and typhoid fever and leptospirosis. So within the Ministry of Health, we prioritize certain communicable diseases. And we have 5 that's of priority to Fiji. These are the ones that can cause outbreaks every now and then. So these ones are the leptospirosis, typhoid, dengue, measles, rubella. So these are the 5 main ones. But we have other communicable diseases also that are of interest and of concern to the ministry. So these are TB and HIV and so forth. And they have their own vertical programs that run.
Yes, okay. So these are all virus-related, unlike non-communicable diseases where it's lifestyle. So still on the dengue fever, now you have mentioned that it is right now endemic rather than an epidemic outbreak. So you might like to elaborate on that, Dr. Kama.
Well, the difference between an endemic and an epidemic event. So an endemic event is basically an event that is usual. So we have in Fiji, you know, dengue cases that pop up every year. So, but there's a number. There's a number that there's a cutoff number that we basically look at and monitor on. So the numbers are basically like five in a week for the each of the divisions. So we get around about 200 to 300 cases in a year, and that's normal for dengue. And it really depends on the serotype also. Anything above that, we would perhaps measure it against a threshold. So a threshold is what we've designed, where if it goes above the threshold, then we would probably call an outbreak.
Right. Yeah. So I see. We're still on 85. So if it gets to about 200, and then that would be quite serious.
Not exactly. So we have different numbers for different weeks. So it's not a total number of the end of the year. So what we do is we monitor in what they call epi weeks. So there's 52 epi weeks in a year. And every one of those weeks, they have to be registering around five. So now when you have 85 within a matter of 3 weeks, so this is a huge number. So this is why there's the concern from the ministry, because it has gone past their threshold.
I see.
Yes.
So we could be expecting more cases. And like you've said, but there's another thing, you know, when a patient presents his illness to the doctor, sometimes it can be very similar to dengue fever. So how is it that you can tell a confirmed case of dengue fever?
Yes. So the ministry and the health workers, they work on what you call a case definition. So case definition has what you call suspected cases, and there's the confirmed cases. So with suspected cases, these are mostly clinical cases of the disease. So doctor will perhaps diagnose on that basis that you might have fever, red eyes, some rash, joint pains. So if you have that, then there's the suspicion that it may be dengue. But then there's a myriad of other diseases that also present in the same way. So for you to have confirmation, you need a laboratory test. So a confirmed case of dengue also includes a laboratory test that is positive for dengue fever.
I see. So how is that carried out, doctor?
Yeah, so we have in the divisions, they have in the divisions and the subdivision, all the subdivision hospitals, they have what you call dengue rapid test kits. So when someone presents, the doctor sends off blood, and then the laboratory in that hospital basically tests it. And then if it is positive, then it is sent across to a reference lab up at in Tamavo at Mataika House, a public health laboratory. And it basically confirms this test. So there's two sets of tests. So the first test will allow immediate response on the ground. The second test for confirmation is more for surveillance purposes for our end. So we need laboratory confirmed tests for us to have really big response. A huge response on the ground will require the ministry to have laboratory diagnosed cases. So now, right now, the laboratory diagnosed cases we have is 85. But if you take, for instance, the suspected case that would have come out of from this 85 cases, would have been a broad-based, really a huge population we would suspect.
Thank you, Dr. Kama. Now, maybe to our friend, Mr. Rama, do you think there'll be any spraying of insecticide anytime soon?
Yes, currently the places were like for the northern division, wherever there is any dengue case, the insecticide spraying is been carried out. And likewise in the in Lautoka as well. It is like for every case of dengue, they have a 200 meter radius around which area they have to carry out the cleanup campaign, remove all the breeding grounds before we do the spraying. And the spraying is just an intermittent way of just stopping the transmission or killing the adult mosquitoes, but just to stop the transmission from one person to the other person. But to completely get rid of dengue, we have to clean up and prevent mosquito breeding in that area.
I'm sure this is what the Ministry of Health is stressing. Yes, Mr. Rama, you've got a lot of experience. And this nasty mosquito, I suppose you studied that mosquito too, did you?
Yes, we have been studying with the mosquitoes regarding the behavior of the mosquitoes. And sometimes people say, how come dengue is still coming in and out? Like the mosquito that spreads dengue normally lays egg in the containers, not directly in water. And if the mosquito is infected with dengue virus, so when they lay eggs, that generation of mosquitoes that will come up also has that dengue virus. So that's sometimes some people say, okay, there's no dengue, no people with dengue currently in Suva, and how come there's all of a sudden So these mosquito eggs may hatch later.
The cycle goes on.
The cycle goes on.
Okay, so like, what is the name of that mosquito?
It's called Aedes aegypti, the main mosquito.
The main mosquito. Yes. So how long has dengue fever been in Fiji? Any idea? 20 years, 30 years, or ever since time began?
Yes, so basically, Louise, the literature that's there in the World Wide Web on dengue fever in Fiji dates back right to the 1800s.
Wow.
But the studies, I think, around the 1950s. In the 1960s, there was a national survey just to find out more about dengue. I think the establishment that that it is endemic to Fiji was made during that study. So it dates us back to 1950s. So this was a study that was conducted by, I think, Dr. Mataika and some other researchers from London. So that established that dengue was endemic in Fiji right from that time.
Quite a long time ago. And yes, like you said, it was interesting also that the people kind of get immune to dengue fever, but then it depends on the different rates that you've given, 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yes, the serotypes, Louise, there's a different serotypes. We see the same things happening in other parts of Asia. Say, for instance, in Singapore, the health system is quite intact. It's quite advanced. But then they keep getting outbreaks of dengue fever. But this is because of the co-circulation of different serotypes. So, you know, there's two or three serotypes of dengue circulating at the same time in Singapore. They've got a good control of dengue, of mosquitoes, but then they keep getting outbreaks. So it doesn't really matter how much of mosquito is there in terms of density. But you have, you know, these co-circulations of different serotypes of dengue, outbreaks can keep happening, no?
Yes.
So we are moving towards that phase very quickly now. So like I said, there's lots of, there's a myriad of factors. It can be virus related, can be due to the mosquito density, can be due to, you know, so all of these things working in unison or even alone can bring this up.
Vinaka, Dr. Karma, we'll be back on Speak Your Mind, and we will cover how, well, the symptoms Dr. Karma has already mentioned, but the treatment. We'll be back shortly. Speak Your Mind on Gold FM, only the classic hits, and we have the pleasure of the company of the National Advisor of Communicable Diseases, Dr. Karma, who has been telling us all about dengue fever. Now, dengue fever is an awful sickness to have. I remember when I was little, I had it and I actually had blood coming out from my nose. That was when I was really little, so I had a really bad experience, terrible pain and fever. And it's really important on how you react to the early symptoms. And, of course, you'd be the best person to tell us, Dr. Karma.
Yes, thank you, Louise. I think I've described the early symptoms early on. And these are one of fever. You should have, you know, people who get dengue fever basically have a fever. So it has to be high fever. And then you'll also have perhaps, you know, a few days later, joint pains, and there's the onset of what they call conjunctivitis, or red eyes. There's muscle aches and also joint aches. So these are the symptoms that one would experience within perhaps 3 or 5 days of following infection, after mosquito bite, infected mosquito bite. So if it carries on, the clinical spectrum is that, well, the complications are one of dengue hemorrhagic fever and dengue shock syndrome. So this is the main difference with other, you know, other viruses that are circulating in the Pacific, like chikungunya and Zika.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, it can be fatal when it reaches that stage. So dengue hemorrhagic fever, so basically there's bleeding, there's hemorrhage, and if the hemorrhage, the bleeding goes into the lungs, etc. then it can be fatal in that sense. And then you can get shock, and then you just deteriorate from then onwards.
So this would be a serious strain, obviously, when you'd have all this bleeding.
So this is the reason why we try and serotype. So when we serotype and we know the dengue type, and if it's different from the dengue one, the endemic type that circulates in Fiji, the endemic type, then basically all our clinicians tend to get worried because of the possibility of this complication arising. So there's a mechanism like they call it the pathophysiology. Within the body, when you know a second serotype invades, so it enhances responses that are too great for the body to take immunologically, so that bleeding happens. So all the blood vessels tend to leak blood, and then it hemorrhages out into really important organs, especially the lungs and so forth.
I see. So what would you advise people to do if they suspect having dengue fever? I mean, what is the treatment that doctors would give? If, of course, you would say to go quickly to a doctor. And from then, what does the doctor give as treatment to a person who suffers from dengue fever?
Well, it really depends on, what they present with. But mostly if, someone identifies or, recognizes that they are having the symptoms of dengue, as early as possible, present to the nearest health center, they will get, because there's no vaccine at the moment, although there's a vaccine that has been, cleared by in Mexico, but we're still waiting for the WHO to give us the proper advice, whether to take on that vaccine or not.
Okay.
So there is a vaccine. We haven't started to even use that vaccine. But otherwise, there's no other cure at the moment. What the doctors will do for those kind of milder forms of the disease, they will provide them perhaps some things like paracetamol and advise them on hydration. So they drink lots of fluids. And then look at the signs and symptoms, monitor themselves to see whether bleeding occurs, etc. They have to present again to hospital.
I see. So a lot of rest, I suppose, as
yes,
well. A lot
absolutely.
Of rest and controlling the fever would be really important,
yes.
obviously.
Yes.
Because even fever can kill itself if you don't control it.
Yeah, so fever in kids can be quite an issue if it's really quite high. But in adults, this is also a protective mechanism in humans. Because it tends to kill off the bugs. Higher temperatures will kill off the bugs. So sometimes it's good, but at other times it can be problematic to the adults. That's why we basically advise on taking paracetamol, things that will calm down the fever.
Yes, because sometimes when children have fever, just when you wipe them and give them, even when you give them paracetamol, that fever jumps back really fast.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, you're supposed to drink paracetamol every 6 hours?
Yes, absolutely. So if you have a very high fever, sometimes they advise you to take paracetamol every 4 hours, but it has to be the right dose, just for a short period until your fever is controlled. But there's also other things like using tepid sponge. So that can also work in bringing down the fever. So this combination of things. But it's also important to have a good meal, a well-balanced diet, and also fluids. So this will boost your immunity to handle,
handle the virus.
Yeah, the invasion.
Oh, okay. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Kama. But very interesting, a topic, kind of making it headlines around the world. The World Health Organization, they had an emergency meeting today to find ways to curb the Zika virus, which is linked to birth defects and spreading like wildfire throughout the Americas. Now, what is the Zika virus, Dr. Kama?
Zika virus is, it's almost like the dengue virus. In fact, the virologists, they have grouped them in the same family as as a flavivirus. So it almost acts just like dengue virus when they're grouped that way. Just the name Zika virus, it started off and it was identified, I think, in 1947 or so in the Zika forests of Uganda, and that's where it got its name.
Okay.
So, but basically, it has the same. It works the same way as dengue. It will be carried by the same mosquito, which is the Aedes aegypti that Rama had mentioned, and it will work the same way as Zika. Only at the beginning, it's not well known. The clinical spectrum, how far it can go in in affecting people's lives. So that hasn't been fully understood yet. What we understand, though, is that it will give out mild disease in the beginning, because that's in all the other outbreaks that have happened in the past in Africa and South Asia, and also the Americas recently, where we see its association with other complications. And this is microcephaly.
Yes.
So birth defects and also what they call Guillain-Barré syndrome. So this is all neurological complications of the disease that they have association with, but no real concrete evidence that it provides this. But researches are still ongoing. The research is still ongoing to see what the linkage is.
Okay, so Dr. Kama, have you had any confirmed cases of the Zika virus in Fiji before?
Yes, Louise. In last year, we had two cases. We were trying to track the two cases. We understood that they were either travelers here in Fiji, whether they were visitors. The name suggested that, but when we tried to contact them, they were nowhere again to be found in Fiji. So this information came through from a private hospital, and we were able to diagnose the case, laboratory diagnosed the confirmation of for Zika virus for both cases.
Okay, so what is the Ministry of Health doing now in regards to containing the Zika virus, just as a precautionary measure?
Yeah, so in terms of contingency, prevention contingency on importation and establishment of Zika virus, this has been ongoing from last year, right from July. Our situation in Fiji is that being the hub of travelers in the Pacific, our risks are quite high. The ministry understands that. And the other risk that we have is that we have the vector here, the mosquito vector here in abundance, because they are the same vectors as dengue. So even just these two aspects here makes us quite at risk. So we've been basically working in the ministry to try and surveil it better and to see whether it will come in or not. So the first thing is for it to get into the country. So it has to come in. The other thing is for it to establish itself in Fiji, amongst our population and also the mosquitoes. So that's the surveillance activity we've been doing since July. We've been able to pick up two cases. So far after that, we haven't picked up any other cases, although we've been testing blood and so forth all this while.
Okay, Dr. Kama, we'll be back with more on Gold FM, only the classic hits. Speak your mind. This is Speak Your Mind on Gold FM, only the classic hits. And we're talking to the National Advisor from the Ministry of Health of Communicable Diseases. And an interesting topic that we've been covering is the Zika virus. Now, Dr. Kama, say for instance, for someone who has come through a port of entry with the Zika virus, what would be the steps the Ministry of Health will take?
Currently, that is... That is an issue at the border that is quite difficult to control at the moment. We can do it for other conditions, and these conditions are the ones that we can diagnose on arrival. So they should look sick. But in terms of Zika, there is this concept about the incubation period where people continue to look well. So it's very difficult to pick that up unless you're testing at the border. So in terms of incubation period, people will continue to remain well until 3 to 5 days. Then they start to develop symptoms. This is after the mosquito bite and the infection starts. So if someone is coming through the border during that incubation period, he's been bitten, he's undergoing the incubation period, we'll miss him in the border, miss him or her at the border. So that they will come in and then perhaps the mosquito will pick up through a blood meal the virus and starts transmitting it. So for us at the Ministry of Health, what we try and do is basically to control the mosquito density and continue to surveil the population, people who present with such symptoms. So this is the area. We have to put our indicators and our nets out there for surveillance, wider than just the border.
I see. Now, where can the virus infection test be confirmed? Do we do it here, or is there somewhere else where you can get the virus infection test confirmed?
Yes, so we have a good working relationship with the Institut Louis Malade in French Polynesia. They are our reference lab at the moment for Zika virus. And that's where we basically send all our requests for Zika virus testing. So the Institut Louis Malade. And our focal point is Dr. Mai, Dr. Van Mai.
Okay, so maybe Mr. Rama, you know, when the mosquito, the one that we're talking about, when it bites someone, I mean, sucks the blood, so how is it spread again?
Suppose a person is infected with dengue and then the mosquito takes a blood meal from that person. So that mosquito becomes infected, and after the mosquito lays egg, definitely it comes back to bite and take another blood meal. Then the virus is transmitted again from that mosquito to a healthy person, and then the second person, who is a healthy person, the virus multiplies and gets sick, and that cycle continues again. And the other one is when the mosquito lays egg with, he's already infected with dengue virus, that egg, the next generation of mosquito that will come out from that egg will inherit that dengue virus, and the transmission will automatically go from that mosquito to another healthy person.
So this sickness can be, this virus can be spread pretty quickly like that if you don't contain the mosquitoes, obviously.
Yes,
like you've said.
Yeah. The most important thing is whether it's a Zika virus or dengue virus or
chikungunya,
it's all spread by same mosquitoes. So we just need to prevent these mosquitoes from breeding, destroy their breeding sites, and protect ourselves from being bitten by the mosquitoes.
I mean, we stay in a tropical country. It's very hard not to get bitten by mosquitoes, but you can do your best. Like you said, wear long trousers, socks, and all that.
Especially when we are saying, okay, we have dengue situations here. So we have to play our part. Each individual has to play their part. Keep their compounds clean. If you keep the compounds clean, definitely the mosquitoes won't be coming in. And if you remove all the breeding sites, the artificial containers, so the mosquitoes won't be breeding.
Cutting long grass and cleaning your drains.
Yes. And covering all the drums and with that you are storing water with. So that prevents breeding of mosquitoes.
This is very important because, I mean, look at the Americas, what's happening to them. So if we act now, I'm sure we won't get any Zika virus. Eh, Dr. Kama?
Oh, yes, absolutely. You know, these mosquitoes, the virus and the mosquitoes, they are quite, you know, they're quite specific in the way that they work. So that the virus will infect. They will infect the mosquito, and they will infect the humans when given the opportunity to be transmitted to humans. And the mosquito will take the blood meal. They will grow. They will take the blood meal. It's for the human to know what they are supposed to do. So the primary thing is to clean the compound, to get rid of all the mosquito breeding sites, and also to protect themselves from mosquito bites. This is fundamental. So like Rama had mentioned, physical barriers are important. Personal repellents are what we need. So the physical barriers, mosquito nettings and so forth that he's mentioned, even the wearing of long sleeve clothes. So all these are important. And also, you know, the mess cleanups. So you have mess cleanups. You have your own compound to clean, your household, and then to contribute to mass sanitization of the environment. So those ones basically will clear up, you know, settlements and so forth that can't dispose of garbage like the legal ones that we have around. So those mess cleanup campaigns are for those areas.
Yeah, so it's really important to work together as a community so dengue fever can be, well, hopefully eradicated. And you know how you have airplanes that come in or boats? I'm sure government continue to spray. They use insecticide normally.
Yes, basically those are that is to prevent other species of mosquitoes or any insects coming into our country, which can affect our agriculture side or our health side or whatever. for example, those the aircrafts coming from malarial ports, we do the spraying. It's at the on arrival spray, so that prevents in case by chance there is any Anopheles mosquitoes that comes in, which spreads malaria. So we do not have malaria mosquitoes in Fiji. So that is one of the reasons why we do the spraying, to prevent any foreign species of insects getting into our country.
So how often do you and your team do this?
It's done at all ports of entry by all the health inspectors at the airports and seaports.
Well, that's very good.
As soon as any foreign vessel comes in from any malarial ports.
So every single boat, yes. Every single airplane?
Yes.
It's done on a daily basis?
Yeah. Oh. It's an expensive exercise, but it's worth doing that rather than getting some insect that can be really devastated to our country.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Mr. Rama, for that. But we cannot stress the point enough as to being responsible, keeping your compounds clean. And Dr. Kama, what would be your advice to the listener about what to do for dengue fever?
Well, basically, I think the important thing we've discussed already, and that is preventing being infected. So primarily, protecting oneself from mosquito bites, and also reducing the source of mosquitoes from the breeding sites, disposing of it, and also identifying the symptoms as early as possible and presenting to the nearest health facility for diagnosis. So I think these are things that we have discussed in the past. Dengue fever is not new to everyone. So in Fiji, at least. It's the same advice over and over again. And the fundamental thing is to keep the mosquito density down. And to do that, for us to clean up our compounds and also join in mass sanitization campaigns for the environment. So I think that's basically the advice that we'd like to reiterate.
And it's been seen to be a good response in the past. So we could do that again. You know how communities get together, even business houses and all that?
Yeah, so fundamentally, if you control that and you control all arboviruses, all other arboviruses disease, like Zika virus and chikungunya, so this is our main focus. If we control the mosquito, then we control the other disease. Already high risk, so we don't want what's happening in America, in the Americas, like Brazil and so forth, to come here. Once we get a surge in Zika virus, then we'll be looking at all these neurological complications, if there's real association with it at the moment. Now, if that is the case, then we are looking at a big burden, not only to communities and individuals and families, but also to our health system and our nation. We can't afford to be looking after like neurological complications of this disease. And in Brazil, these numbers are significantly high. For birth defects like microcephaly, small brain, the small sizes of the brain, abnormally small,
yeah.
You'll have to look after them over how many years, and they're probably going to be either, paralyzed or, they're deformed. deformations. So to have that in any family and in a health system, that would probably be a very costly exercise.
Vinaka, Dr. Kama, thank you so much for your great words of advice, and also thank you very much, Mr. Rama. And just keep in mind, do keep your communities clean as well as your households. Thank you for Speak Your Mind on Gold FM, only the classic hits. We'll be back again next Tuesday with more live on radio and the delayed coverage shown on FBC TV every Tuesday night and Wednesday morning. Nisa Mwademanda.